Hello, dear viewer. Apparently, you're interested in air-to-air guided missiles. One of them, and thus topic of this video, is the Ruhrstahl Kramer X4, a design from the Second World War. Main source for this video is the publication OP-1666, German Explosive Ordnance, Volume 1, from the Department of the Navy, Bureau of Ordnance, published in June 1946. That listed and described German weapon systems from World War II. Note that I didn't have access to original German documentation or a complete X4 missile. So details of original internal components may look different in my animations. Aim of this video is to inform you about the history behind the X4 and how it worked. For this, I'm going to explain what the X4 was and its historic background. After that, I'm going to talk about the components of the X4 and how rocket motor, guidance system and the fuse worked. And after that, I will explain how the X4 was built and how a successful X4 mission would have looked like. The Ruhrstahl X4 was a wire-guided air-to-air missile and should be used against bombers to keep the attacking plane out of their defensive gun range. The X4 had an aluminum body with four wooden wings. At the back was a tilted, cross-shaped tail section. The X4 was controlled with the FUG-510 Düsseldorf and a joystick nicknamed Knirps. The commands reached the X4 over a pair of wires that unwound from coils and canisters at the wingtips. Flares were fixed on the other pair of wingtips to increase visibility. The FUG-238 Detmold decoded the commands and switched the magnetic actuators that acted on the control surfaces. A BMW 109-548 rocket motor fueled with S-Stoff and R-Stoff, propelled the missile to speeds around 900 km per hour. The X4 carried a 20-kilo high-explosive warhead made from dinitroglycol. The acoustic proximity fuse Kranich detonated the warhead at a distance of 7 meters from the target. The X4 could also be detonated by an impact fuse or remotely by the pilot. A time fuse destroyed the missile 35 seconds after the launch automatically. Heavy bombardment of German cities led to a demand for increasingly powerful anti-aircraft weapons. The Reichsair Ministry wanted to increase the accuracy of fighter-based rockets to deal with the growing numbers of enemy bombers and prevent dangerous situations for pilots and aircraft in the defensive gun range. Development of the X4 was started under Dr. Max Kramer at Ruhrstahl in early 1943. A development order under number GLC-8-344 was given by the Reichsluftfahrtministerium in June 1943. The missile should be cheap in production and easy to assemble by untrained workers. It was known that Dr. Kramer's RC-controlled Fritz X was susceptible to jamming, so the X4 received a jam-proof and cheaper wire control system, the Düsseldorf Detmold Control Link, manufactured by Telefunken. Development for the X4's power plant was started under Dr. Zubrowski at BMW in January 1943, as Project P3378. Project P3378 received the RLM code 109-548. The BMW design used a hypergolic mixture of R-Stoff and SV-Stoff, which made the fueling process very dangerous. Thus, it was decided to replace it as soon as possible with the Schmidding 109-603 solid fuel rocket motor. The missile was first tested on August 11, 1944, and soon after air-launched in September 1944 from a Focke-Wulf 190 F8. It was found that piloting the aircraft and steering the missile was too difficult for a single man, so the X4 was also test-fired from JU-88 and JU-188 with more crew members. There was also a test flight of a Messerschmitt 262 jet fighter with two X-4s under the wings. The Aircar 344 project survived Generalmajor Dornberger's cancellation wave in December 1944, but was terminated on February 6th after the BMW factory in Stargard was bombed and all rocket motors at this plant were lost. Test flights continued after the cancellation, and there are unconfirmed claims that the Ruhrstall X-4 was test-fired in a combat situation. At least 224 X-4s were built, with another 1,000 nearing completion. No X-4 was officially delivered to the Luftwaffe. Main components of an air-to-air missile are the rocket motor, its guidance system, the warhead, and its fuses. In the X-4, those were the BMW 109-548 rocket engine with the Tetragonic fuels S-Stoff and R-Stoff. The guidance system used a joystick named Knirps, which manipulated polarity and current in the master circuit between Düsseldorf and Detmold device to signal the commands to the missile. A pair of relays in the Detmold device decoded them and operated the solenoids on the control surfaces. A gyroscope was used to give the missile a sense of up and down. The warhead could be exploded by four different fuses. To simplify aiming, the X-4 should be able to explode near the target on its own. For this, the acoustic proximity fuse Kranich was developed, which reacted to the noise emissions of enemy bombers. Eyecatcher of the BMW 109-548 are the spiral fuel tanks housed in the midsection of the X-4. The combustion chamber sits at the aft end. Inside the outer SV-Stoff tank and inner Airstoff tank sits the compressed air bottle. Two explosive charges open the air valves and the compressed air forces pistons through the fuel tanks. The liquids are pushed into the combustion chamber. Airstoff enters directly, but SV-Stoff is cycled around the combustion chamber to cool it and increase the reactivity of SV-Stoff. Rocket motors require no outside air for the combustion like a jet engine or a piston engine would. Instead, they carry an oxidizer for the reaction with the fuel. In case of the X-4, SV-Stoff was the oxidizer and R-Stoff the fuel. SV-Stoff, nicknamed Salbei, was a mixture from 94% nitric acid and 6% nitrogen tetroxide. As you can see, nitric acid carries a lot of oxygen. R-Stoff was a mixture made from 57% xylidine and 43% of triethylamine. This mixture was also called Tonka. Airstoff contains a lot of hydrocarbons. SV-Stoff and Airstoff react with each other and turn into carbon dioxide, nitrogen gas and water vapor. The reaction releases so much energy in form of heat that the components ignite on impact. The heated gases are pushed out of the combustion chamber at high speed and accelerate the rocket according to Newton's third law, Aktio est Reaktio, in the opposite direction. The guidance system is the most interesting component of the X-4, but to understand its secrets, you need to know what electromagnetism is. You're probably familiar with the normal ferromagnetism. The magnet is in essence a big piece of iron that has magnetic field lines running around it. The field lines exit the magnet at the North Pole, bend around it, and enter at the South Pole. Magnetic fields can also be created by currents in a conductive material. When charges move through a piece of wire, a circular magnetic field is created. To find the direction of the magnetic field lines, give your screen a thumbs up with your right hand. The direction in which your thumb is pointing is the direction of current, and the direction in which your fingers are bent is the direction of the magnetic field lines. A single wire is not very efficient at creating strong magnetic fields. To make a good electromagnet, the wire is turned into a spiral. The magnetic fields combine and the coil will produce a magnetic field very similar to the familiar magnet. With a magnetic field at hand that can be turned on and off at will by a switch, there can be made a lot of cool devices, one of which is the relay. The relay is in essence just a switch that can be operated by an electric current. With some manipulation, the relay can be made responsive to the electric power or its polarity. For example, by placing a spring here, the switch will only be operated when the current in the coil is strong enough to create a magnetic field that overcomes the force of the spring. By placing a magnet on the switch, the relay will react to the polarity of the current in the coil. Electromagnets can also be used to create magnetic actuators or solenoids. The solenoid can initiate movement by attracting metal to the magnetic field. By use of two coils or a magnet, the solenoid can work in two directions. To understand the engineering solutions and design choices in the X-Force guidance system, let's see how the missile was steered. The control surfaces on the cross-shaped tail section are controlled by solenoids. The solenoids have no neutral position, so the X-Force radar can only project to the left or right. To get the missile on a straight course, the radars have to alternate automatically between the left and right position. This alternation is initiated by the guidance system 5 times per second. To steer the missile in a preferred direction, the time that the radar would project to one side has to be longer than the time it would project to the opposite side in one period. The solenoids operated on the missile's 9-volt onboard power supply. The X-Force internal circuits are switched by a pair of relays, which themselves are controlled by changes in polarity, this means direction, and current of the guidance system's master circuit. Set changes in polarity and value of current are created by the pilot in the detmold device by moving the joystick, nicknamed Knirps. In the guidance system were two rotating drums. On those drums were two conductive surfaces in triangular shape that were insulated against each other. The drums were turning at a rate of 5 rotations per second. By moving the joystick, sliding contacts were moved over the conductive surfaces of the turning drums. To make the system easy understandable, I simplified the surfaces on those drums in 5 easy distinguishable zones. The azimuth drum is connected to the guidance system power source. The polarity in the circuit can now alternate according to the position of the contacts. To control the power in the master circuit, one contact of the azimuth drum is wired to the contact of the elevation drum. By turning this drum, the current in the circuit is alternated between low and high current, most likely by use of a strong and weak resistor. When a joystick is in neutral position, each electric lead is contacted for the same amount of time, and each capacitor is contacted for the same amount of time. So in 1/5 of a second, the drum makes a full rotation. The polarity is switched. The value of current is changed. The polarity is switched back, and the value of current is reset. The relays in the missile react to the polarity and current changes and switch the internal circuits. The azimuth relay detects a change in polarity and switches the solenoid in opposite direction. The elevation relay detects a lower current and switches its adjacent solenoid. When the polarity is changed back, the azimuth relay makes the azimuth solenoid turn around. When the current is back at the initial level, The elevation relay switches the internal circuit and the elevation solenoid jumps back to the other side. In a full second, this happens 5 times. Let's assume the pilot wants the missile to go in upward direction. When a joystick is pushed upwards, the position of the contacts on the elevation drum is changed. As you can see, the polarity is alternating, but the current can't change. So the elevation relay won't change the position of the solenoid, while the azimuth relay reacts to the polarity changes and switches the solenoid. The missile will steer in a steep climb. If the pilot wants the missile to stay in the climb but also move slowly to the left, the contact on the azimuth drum is moved to the left. The second contact moves to the right to ensure proper connection of the master circuit with the power supply. The polarity in the circuit is still alternating, but one direction is activated for 3/4 of a cycle, while the opposite direction is activated for just 1/4 of a drum rotation. The relays switch the missile's internal circuits accordingly, and the azimuth control surface projects longer to the left than to the right. The missile is climbing fast while moving slowly to the left. This system would work fine if the missile isn't rotating around its length. Otherwise, the right-facing control surface would be downward-facing after 1/4 of a rotation and face in opposite direction after another 1/4 rotation. Unfortunately, the Ruhrstall X4 was spin-stabilized. To solve those problems, the missile had a gyroscope and a commutator system. Explaining the gyroscope would take too much time, so I will only describe what a gyroscope does. A gyroscope looks like a metal wheel. Once it's spinning fast enough, it will counteract any force that tries to change the angle of its axis it was spun up in. This effect is used to make the commutator stay level even though the missile is spinning around it. The commutators are fixed to the gyroscope and are used to feed the correct commands to the spinning solenoids. The radial commutator rings are connected to the spinning azimuth and elevation relay, keeping their commands in horizontal direction regardless of their position. Those signals are then put on the double ring commutator, where the signal is passed on to the solenoid. As you may notice, the rings are quartered. This is done because an azimuth control surface and its adjusting solenoid become an elevation control surface after 1/4 of a rotation. Thus the command for the solenoid has to be a different one. Opposite 1/4 rings are wired vice versa because the right signal on the top has to become a left signal at the bottom. For simplification, I changed the command to steep climb and hard right, so that the signal in the master circuit does not change. That should make the effects of the gyro commutator easier to understand in the following animation. Observe for yourself. A proximity fuse is a device that detonates a warhead automatically at a predefined distance to a target. This makes a direct hit unnecessary. Proximity fuses measure the distance to the target in many different ways. The most successful design of the Second World War was the Allied Variable Time or VT fuse, which responded to radar reflections. Der X-Force Acoustic Proximity Fuse, Kranich, was developed by Rheinmetall Borsig and responded to the noise emissions of its target. To be precise, the Doppler shift when passing a B-17's engine. The Doppler shift can be heard as change of pitch of a passing ambulance siren. Same with the engine noise of a passing plane. This happens because the frequency of the sound waves relative to the observer changes. The wavefronts of the approaching plane are compressed, resulting in a high frequency for the observer. This changes when the plane has passed. Its wavefronts are stretched out, resulting in a low frequency. This also works the other way around when the observer is moving past a stationary sound source. In case of the X4, the acoustic proximity fuse, or the observer in the system, is approaching close to the speed of sound. The source, here the B-17's engine, appear to be stable at this high speed difference. The result are a high frequency and a high pitch during the approach, and a low frequency and low pitch after the missile has passed. The acoustic fuse receives the sound with a small diaphragm. It is vibrating at the same frequency as the sound waves. At its base is a thin metal strip, a so-called reed, that vibrates at the same frequency as the diaphragm. When the missile is passing, the frequency drops and the reed starts resonating. The vibrations of the diaphragm pile up to an extent that make the reed bend. After the pass, the frequency drops lower than resonance frequency of the reed. When the missile passes close enough, the metal reed is resonating so violent that it bends far enough to close the electric circuit and the fuse and fire the electric detonator, which explodes the warhead. In essence, Kranich is a switch that's activated by a predetermined sound wave frequency. It was found that Kranich was a promising design. Acoustic fuses are in obscurity today because they don't work in supersonic flight. The X4 was designed to be assembled from prefabricated parts by unskilled workers. The Ruhrstahl factory in Bragwede assembled the body from a cast centerpiece and welded aluminum sheets. The rocket motor was built by the BMW factory in Stuttgart. All components were shipped to an ammunition factory, where prisoners of war would pre-fuel the rocket motor with Airstoff and would combine rocket motor, body, electrical components and a gyroscope. The prefabricated body was packed together with the plywood wings from a local woodworker and the acoustic fuse in a case. This case was shipped together with the detonator, a barrel of Essstoff and a warhead, which was made from turned steel and filled with dinitroglycol explosive from the Luftwaffenmunitionsanstalt of the local Air Force sector to the airfield. Before a mission could start, the X4 kit had to be assembled by the troops. The pre-fueled rocket was filled with the Essstoff oxidizer and the warhead was installed. The gyro and the electric components were tested. After that, the Kranich fuse was tested and the wings were bolted onto the body. At last, the battery was inserted and the detonator and fuse were screwed in place. The ready X4 would then be hung on an ETC-70 C1 launch rack. Up in the air, the pilot would close in at the enemy bomber formation. At a distance of 2,500 to 1,500 meter, He would aim at the bomber and press the selector button for one of his loaded X-4. When the pilot wanted to attack, he pressed another button, which electrically fired a small charge on the gyroscope, making it spin. After that, the pilot pressed the release button, which fired the piercing detonators on the compressed air bottle. The expanding air forced the pistons in the rocket motor to squirt S-Stoff and R-Stoff in the combustion chamber. At the same time, the tracers were ignited, a pyrotechnic train was started, and the missile was released. 7 seconds after the launch were all fuses activated by the pyrotechnic train. When the missile came in the pilot's view, he would steer the bright burning tracer over the silhouette of a bomber and keep it there by moving the joystick. The acoustic fuse would then detect the noise emissions of the bomber 15 meters away and activate a delay fuse that let the missile explode at a distance of 7 meters to the bomber. The pilot would then jettison the remains of the control wires by a lever. The missile would be self-destroyed by a slow-burning fuse 35 seconds after the launch should the pilot fail to hit anything. It was planned to make the X-4 self-guiding by use of the Poodle homing device. The Poodle device was a carbon microphone that was mounted at an angle of 60 degrees to the rotational axis of the missile. The resistance of the microphone changed with the noise level. The rotating missile would point the microphone once per rotation at the loud bomber. The subsequent drop in resistance was the electric signal that was processed into the proper commands for the control surfaces. Manufacturing of the X-4 was continued after the war by the French Arsenal de l'Aéronautique, SAA-10. The AA-10 design was dropped in 1950 because of the dangerous fueling procedure. The X-4 would influence the Ruhrstahl X-7 Rotkäppchen ATGM and its French interpretation, the Nord SS-10. So, the video is over. You should now have an idea how the composition of the X-4's rocket motor, guidance system and fuse produced one of the earliest air-to-air missiles. The X-4 missile was very influential, but is due to its scattered and thin source material hard to understand for someone interested. If you found this video helpful in understanding the Ruhrstahl X-4, please consider liking. And if you want to know how the TV guidance system of a glide bomb or the Liechtenstein radar worked, watch my takes on those subjects.